Yeah, the word demise, nigga. Fuck these niggas talking about, nigga. And when they swing that way to the right, you swing to the left, you heard?
Bobby, you're.
Woo! Damn, I ain't been broke in a minute.
All right, thank you everyone for tuning in. My name is Eduardo, and I have with me Bay Area finest, Dare. You want to introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Dare David. I'm a real estate broker and a good long time friend of Tutu. We used to be good buddies out here in the Bay before he went to live the better life in Miami.
It's trying, but, you know.
We've known each other for quite a while now, at least over 10 years, I'll say.
Yes.
Yeah, that's pretty much me, you know. Wonderful. Originally from Niger, you know, brought up in the States and everything, so.
If you yeah. Live in the Bay Area and you don't know Dare, that means that you're not connected, you know. This guy, he knows the Bay, you know, and very... very cultured man, you know, mm-hmm. Always positive. I really enjoy conversations with Dare. So the reason why we're having this conversation today is to kind of like assess the situation as far as real estate. We bring different topics here on the podcast, but then now we just kind of wanted to touch bases and speak about real estate. Dare, what do you think, how do you think Corona has impacted the real estate market these days?
Well, I mean, the coronavirus, you know, took everybody by storm. Nobody was really expecting this. So right now with real estate in particular, real estate is very local. So you have to look at it in two different aspects. You have to look at it from a national, state, local, and statewide. So probably the right sequence is you look at it from a national perspective, from a state perspective, and from a local perspective, because real estate, all in all, is really local business. It's not, you know, people know real estate through their neighborhoods. So the way the pandemic has affected the real estate market right now has been unprecedented. It's just like things that we've never expected before. So right now, as far as, there's different aspects to it. You have the real estate as far as the activities, what we do in terms of how we show homes and how we lease the home is affected that part. In terms of our data set, in terms of the type of how the trends in real estate works, it has affected that as well. So it has affected real estate all in all, because you have to understand real estate is a business of people. So, you know, you have to talk to people. Sometimes you have to sit down with your client. Sometimes you have to sit in the same car. So it's really affected real estate a lot, quite a lot. So for example, in terms of how we show homes, right now it's very difficult on how you show homes. Before you can just, you know, pick up your client, maybe preview the homes before, you know, you do a little research and you meet with the client there. You really can't do that anymore. California is one of the most strictest states in terms of like anything, you know. They like extending the you know, stay at home like it's nothing.
That also affects real estate.
Yeah, and it affects real estate, big deal. So when we want to show a home, typically we just meet up with the client there, we go into the house. The most we'll do is take our shoes off, right? If they give us instructions to take the shoes off. But this time around, there's an actual form that you have to fill out now.
Wow.
That form requires you to cover your nose, covers your hand, covers your feet. It's almost like if you can put up a hazmat suit, they won't mind.
So, they'll be like, okay, this my real estate is going above and beyond.
Exactly. So which brings in the difficulty, like, okay, who brings in the supply? Do I provide the supply to my client? Does my client provide the supply? Is the supply at the property? So there's all kinds of confusion. Wow. And it just makes the client feel that much more anxiety about the whole process, you know, where if they really don't feel like they want to go see that house, they probably won't even book an appointment with you. So it's a little hard. It's a little hard to do showings because of that. Because, you know, when you send that to a client that this is the new procedures, they go like, I don't really need to see that house that hard, you know. And that takes away from real estate because real estate is, in terms of showing a home, it's a two-sided brain thing, you know. You have to see it, feel it. And those
You have to
pictures
feel with
look good
the customer
sometimes
too.
online, but until you see it, you really can't. You can't, it's hard to judge depth, cleanliness, and all that stuff through pictures. Believe me, I've been doing this for 15 years. They have to see the house. So it's affecting that. But there are ways that we're trying to help by doing virtual showings. We're doing things like, you know, there are several tech companies out there that have already been paving that way prior to this pandemic. Like Matterport is a big firm that do like a virtual touring where you just click on it and it takes you to the room, you look upstairs, you can see all over the house. But it requires those listing agents to subscribe to those services and provide them with their listing so that you can see it. So if they don't, then it's hard to show your client those things, right? And there are
Who
other.
does who? Sorry, sorry to cut you off. Who for those virtual tours? Who does the imaging? Who does the pictures for it?
So for the virtual tours, you as an individual can actually go and do a virtual tour without an agent, because, but it's when they lease the property, the biggest, better company that does it, the more easy, the easiest company that you could go and see those pictures is Redfin. There's a I don't know if you ever heard of Redfin.
Redfin, my house,
Yeah,
actually, I bought it off
through
Redfin.
Redfin,
Not
nice.
off Redfin, but I saw Redfin, my house here in
Exactly. So
Miami.
Redfin, they provide a lot of those things, but sometimes other agents don't provide those things. So now it's more critical that those agents actually deploy this type of services for people to view. Otherwise, it limits the amount of activities or how somebody's going to be able to see your house because you don't have those features on your listings. So I know Redfin does it, but it really, the answer to your question is it really. That depends on the real estate listing agent.
Okay.
Because the listing agent has to provide that feature for the client.
Gotcha.
Those tools have to be supplied by the listing agent. That's the thing. It's critical that those listing agent provide those tools. So the Matterport allows you to go through the house. The other tool is a 3D imagery about the kind of like a the house plan, the layout of the house.
Okay.
So that's another one. So the more of those services that the agent provide, the easier it is to do those virtual touring. Otherwise, it's almost very difficult to do. So you can see how more complicated this gets between, oh, you having the have to go through all this process in terms of showing the house and then if the listing agent doesn't provide all these tools, then it makes it that much difficult for that listing to get as much attention or traffic. So that brings me into like sort of like how is the market doing in terms of like you know activities, you know. So if a listing doesn't have those tools, right? Imagine they could be sitting on the market for days.
Right.
You get? So those are the kind of things that we're going through right now. Listings could be very difficult to see because these tools are not provided. A lot of this, you know, social distancing and all this stuff. You can still do real estate in this market. By the way, real estate is actually, we actually consider essential services, by the way.
Right.
But like I said earlier, real estate is very, you know, first you have to look at it from a national perspective where the federal government says we're essential to the economy. But then some states might have a high infection rate and they don't even want you going out at all, right? Or some localities might actually have a very low infection rate and it doesn't matter as long as you practice those social distancing and preventive measures like, you know, covering your mouth with mask and things like that. They might allow you to go out. But believe it or not, the market is actually very strong right now. Yeah. So year to year, we actually nationally we're up 8% in terms of sales. And the terms of in terms of like a medium home prices nationwide, it's been trending up to about maybe close to 300,000, and that's pretty high for a medium home nationwide, you know. So if any of your audience or people that are listening to this want more information, they can either check out my website or my IG. I have all those things in there, and I can send you those links later on. We can shoot them out to the people so they can see some data set.
And actually, the next question, we kind of like brushed it up a little bit, and it was what are the current market trends? And for what I'm learning from you is actually very interesting because you touch bases on a few things. I never imagined that now someone to visit a house, they would have to, wear a mask and possibly wear gloves, and you probably have to stand at a certain distance from them. So these are interesting things to know. The virtual tours, I was familiar with it. They actually always been there, but I'm pretty sure that now there's a greater use to it, because I've noticed I had a property that I was doing Airbnb. It was a lease, and yeah, they were doing more virtual tours for newer customers. So I could see how that would be like, wow. But before it was something that you would just go in there just to kind of like take a glance. But then now I think your virtual tour is actually more of your tour than actually stepping into the place, You probably would feel more comfortable doing your virtual tour and then go there and then just quickly go in and out, but then take your time on your virtual tour, which was the opposite before. You do your virtual tour quickly and then you go in there and then you get that feel. And what you were saying is very important. You can see, you could just see so much, but then a lot of the sale in real estate is actually feel it. You actually have to feel the place.
All right, so we don't have data set for April yet, because April is the last month, but we have for March. This presentation is, we've got people all over the country that's going to be looking at it. So I tailored it more to like a, national audience rather than the local audience. So these are the stats. So as you can see, I was mentioning earlier the trends in terms of a medium price for existing home, they've actually gone up. So this is 2016. They were like in that, low 240s. They were even down to close to 230s. But look at them where they are today. Almost 280. That's across the country. That's pretty good for across the country, And so as far as the actual sales over time, you can see that we an actual sales percentage changes over time. So each year, how much more are they selling for? This year is actually we're nearly breaking as much record as at the highest. Look at it, 8% compared to ever since 2013. I mean, 2000 and also, oh no, this is actually last year compared to last year. This is compared to last year. That's 2019 March and 2020 March. Look at it. This is nationwide, bro.
So it doubles.
It literally doubled. So if, and then the coronavirus kind of hit it at the middle of March, right? Where, it was a full effect across the country, where the stay-at-home orders was actually starting to get executed all across the country. So there were still real estate activities going on. In fact, I closed a deal during March as well. So up till this coronavirus, we were trying to make some of the record-breaking sales in real estate, in the last 10 years.
Wow.
So
So there's so much pent up demand because, you know, you have to think about it, like during that 2008-2009 downturn that we had, real estate developers start building. And even when that market started turning around, they still didn't started building right away. But by the time they started building, they were catching up for, you know, 10 years of no inventories, you know, even up till now. So there's a lot of pent up demand. So as you can see also in terms of existing sales percentage year to year, we also up. This is 2019, 2020. It's the same thing, but it's just using percentile over in terms of sales itself, the actual sales price. So it's same 8%. You see the correlation here. Also using medium percentage.
Okay. And what those these numbers mean, go back up a little bit. Right here, 2019, it looks like in December, January, and February, it was really good. Total existing home sales.
Yeah, this is total existing, the total existing home sales percentage year over year. So in terms of the year before, how much a home was sell compared to the year after. So okay. Year 2019 in March, there were less homes sold compared to the year 2020 March.
I see.
So now there are actually more homes sold right now. The percentage is a negative. Last year there wasn't as much homes sold. When you compare it to this year, last year was a negative, -4.
Got it.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, so that still correlates with amount of, you know, volume of homes. So this is another interesting stuff. This one, you can read a lot into it. So this is like a market condition that you were talking about. In terms of first-time home buyers, you see here in terms of percentile, there are more, this would be more in March. So the darker maroon color is for 2020. And the lighter, which looks almost like a pink, is for 2019. So for 2020, you can see it's up by just 1% in terms of first time home buyer. They're actually more this year than last year.
Wow.
And then in terms of people that are investors, it's a little down. And it's a little down because, you know, I really don't know what the correlation there is, because this is taking. Actually, this is March. So March was when the real estate, the pandemic started hitting big. And the first people that pull away will be obviously investors, because they don't want to take the risk, right?
Right.
So same thing with cash buyers. They're also down 19%. These guys are down 13%. And distressed property sales are kind of the same.
Okay.
But this is nationwide now, you know. Well, you can still see the trend still makes a lot of sense, because obviously if you're buying for the first time, and corona or no corona, where 70% of people right now are still employed, you know, and they're buying for the first time, they're still going to go out and buy regardless. And in terms of investors, they're going to pull back greatly because, you know, they're more risk averse because, you know, market condition matters a lot to them, right?
Right.
And the same thing with cash buyers. You know, if you're going to throw a lot of cash into buying a home in a very distressed market, this is not even a distressed market. This is an uncertain market.
Right.
Distressed market would be, there's reason why the market is distressed because of some economic issues. This is something unheard of. This is just crazy. The only reason the first-time home buyers are buying because these guys are probably part of that 70%. That have a job, you know. Does this make any sense?
They're already on the way to buy one, so they're like, you know, because I'm pretty sure there's even people that are moving for new jobs and stuff like that. You know, it's not as big numbers, but people already had plans. You know,
exactly. So this is a fascinating one right here. Regionally, look at the part of the countries they're doing the most sales.
South. Wow.
Yeah.
Huh. It's probably part of it is probably here in Miami.
Yeah, I guess so. You know, South will be Florida, Georgia, all those areas. You have Atlanta, Georgia, which is one of the fastest places people move to now. You have places like Texas.
Houston, Texas, yeah.
And all those places, people that are moving there are people from the West, you know? And they're used to paying a lot of money for homes, and they're going to these places. The first thing they want to do is like, man, thank God I don't have to rent anymore. I can now buy, you know?
Right.
You know, so just like you, when you moved to Miami, you just like, dude, I can buy now.
Right, that's true.
How numbers were crazy, you know.
And a lot of the also folks from New York are the ones traveling to these places.
Yeah, okay,
that's yeah. The Bay in New York is housing market is very high. So you would say that is it a good time to refinance now?
So as far as refinance is concerned, so I'm gonna get out of this, you know, the rest of this trend, like this one has correlates with seasonal anyway, you know, during, summer home sales, spring's home usually sells for a lot, used to be increase in supply, and they dwindle towards the December time, and then they go back up, and sales, you know, in the South, you see where the numbers are.
Right, right. Those numbers. Yeah, exactly what we were saying.
Yeah, they're not.
So what is the 37%? The maroon color.
The maroon color, the 37%, I think that was north, that's Midwest.
Oh, wow.
So Midwest is, their price points are even less than the South, which is crazy, right?
Wow.
So Midwest generally, you know, the Rust Belt, the Wisconsin, Milwaukee, all those areas, and you know, they're not very expensive and they're very deserted. There's not a lot of human being in those areas.
And then also you don't get as much of a
not high
spread of weather, you know, like they it's probably also cold right now.
Yeah. They're very drastic. You know, Chicago, you go in, it's 1 minute it's freaking humid and crazy, and the next minute it's windy and cold. You know.
Right.
At least Miami, if it's cold, it's cold. If it's hot, it's hot. You know, you're not getting too much fluctuation, right?
And then if it's cold, the next day is probably going to be warm again.
Okay. So your next question was, how is the mortgage trend, right?
Well, that one we already touched bases on, but more so, is it a good time to refinance?
Oh, yeah. So in terms of refinancing, right? Earlier, I don't know if it was late February or early March, that the Fed funds rate, which is the rate that the federal government exchanged with the banks, they lowered it to nearly zero. It was like 0.75 or something, 0.75 or 0.5 or something like that. And that was historical low, and there was a refi boom where a lot of people went and refied. And what ends up happening is if there's a lot of demand for something, right, people start to, you know, charge a little bit more, right?
Right.
Because it's easy pickings. So I had friends that refied recently, a lot of friends that refied recently that were able to save a ton of money. Even people that bought a year or 2 years ago, they were able to save a ton of money, to the point where, you know, they were being thrown all kinds of special deals. But what ends up happening is as that week progressed, there was so much demand for refi, and there was a backload of refi that the appraisal guys were overbooked, and they couldn't go out to get an appraisal for the banks to complete the refinance. So what ends up happening is that a lot of people, the banks started charging extra premium for refi because now it's hard, you know, and everybody wants it. So we can charge a little bit more. So a few weeks after that, a few of my friends that went back and trying to refi later on towards the end of, towards the mid of March or early March, they started finding out that the cost of refinance was actually going up. So the banks were tagging extra more on top, even though they were borrowing for zero rate, they were tagging up more. So that's one of the reasons right now, if you look at the stock market, the financial market, the financial industries are doing really good right now because they're making money in the middle of this craziness.
Crisis, yeah.
Yeah. So, but yeah. So it's, if you want to refi, absolutely, it's a good time to refi. You know, I mean, depending on what your situation is, I'm sure you can still save quite a lot of money, and you can go out there and get a few different options in terms of who can offer you the best rates, you know, compare rates. I'll say it's the best time to refinance right now.
Sounds good. Housing market prediction. It's kind of hard to predict because we cannot really predict how long the situation will go. But, I mean, that's the question. Will it go up or down once the situation?
With all indications right now, it's actually very optimistic in terms of real estate. So number one thing you have to understand is 70% of people are still employed. Like I said, you know, real estate is very local. I could be saying something in a very kind of aggregate general way. And then you also have to look at it in terms of your location, where you live in the country, and what drives your local economy. What drives local economy where I live, which is Silicon Valley, is tech. And if 70% of people are still employed right now, that probably reflects here more than most places, where most of the people over here will probably be in that 70% percentile, in that bracket of that 70%, because a higher percentage of people that work here in tech are very big. So in terms of, therefore in this market, the prediction is based on the pent up demand prior to this epidemic, you know, is that consumer confidence starts to get back up, people feel comfortable, people are getting used to the social distancing, and people kind of get the whole social distancing down to the T, it's going to drive up the real estate market. Believe it or not, there are still homes in the Bay Area that are still selling for record prices in the middle of this, because they're in the right neighborhood, the right school district, you know, and they're ideal. People pay premium for those because, you know, you have old money, you have deep pocket money, you have tech money, you got everything out here. So those guys are not as affected with, you know, what's going on. In fact, they're getting rich because if you look at the stock market for the last 3 weeks, it's been doing good. You know, there's a disconnection between the regular people in this country and the poor people in this country and the rich. The disconnection is so drastic and so far apart that even in the middle of disaster, they are making millions and millions of money, and we are getting locked at home worrying about the government check. They make money in the stock market. So the disconnection.
Those that are making it, I'm making it, huh?
Exactly. It's not even, it's like we live in two different universes. It's alternate universe. You know, the rich people are doubling their millions every second with the use of stock market. The poor people are getting locked at home, waiting, you know, with the exception of maybe people in tech. Even people in tech, some of them are, you know, depending on how involved your tech company is, you know, people in air, I mean, tech industry is one industry. You have everybody else. So it's just not fair to say, okay, every industry has to do with tech. That's not true. You know, that's just one aspect.
And it's interesting to see how this pandemic situation is driving technology. Actually, this is us looking at a world where everything is more remote. You know, you could order more things online. This is actually a flashback into the future. Like, okay, we already had all those things, like we were saying, the virtual tours or whatever, but we wouldn't care because we were outside.
Exactly.
But now you're noticing, like, okay, there's so much that I could do actually from the comfort of my house, and also in a different way to look at the situation is also you also okay not consuming so much, not going so much to the restaurants, not having all these gym memberships, you can actually do it at home. So hopefully there's a lesson, there's a positive lesson in the situation. We're learning the technology, but then also hopefully we're also learning how to become more self-sufficient.
Exactly. And there's two things I picked up from what you just mentioned. Number one is, what comes to mind in terms of an actual particular company was Peloton. I don't know if you know that company. They make those treadmills that people walk on.
Oh, yeah.
Their stock went off the charts. They were getting so much orders. I actually know a personal friend that bought one of those things, and he's not that rich, but he bought it because they have a nice payment plan and all that craziness.
Right.
$1,000 down, you pay $99 a month. It's chump change for him. He bought one, and it's interactive. It's technology. You get on it. I get on it. We get on something similar to this where I can see you. You can see me.
Oh, wow. I didn't know this how it works.
So cool. We choose a background that we want to trail. We want to do, mission pick. We pick it and we do mission pick while we're trailing and seeing each other, And then the Peloton treadmill adjusts the terrain to whatever, if we're going through the steeper part of the mountain, into a one that's not as steep. So imagine all that. So I think it's a fundamental change in terms of technology. It's a turning point in terms of technology where we've been looking at technology, like you said, as a, it's good. Yeah, but I can still do it I can just get in my car and do that. But
I could do it without.
Imagine a world without, So now it's more critical that with technology are now going to really, 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 really take charge. And it's weird that, I was around when the technology was a bust. I was around when technology was a recovery. Now we're going to be around for when technology is going to be the essential.
Yeah.
Going to change our way of life because, and the crazy thing is the fact that this thing happened so fast, it actually put holes in some, it just pulls holes in some even technology companies that, they actually need to even expand more. Can you imagine that Amazon actually was least efficient during this period of time than any other time ever?
You said the least efficient?
They were not as efficient in this pandemic as they were during regular time. Regular time, they usually do good. And you would think they are because you think they
have... probably were overwhelmed, actually.
But they were so overwhelmed. My order, I couldn't call. Amazon wouldn't pick up my phone calls. I was like, what? When did that start happening?
Wow.
Amazon put me on a recording line. And they told you, we'll call you back after the pandemic is over. I was shocked. So imagine how much growth. This guy is going to be the first trillionaire. I saw an article. He's going to be the first trillionaire in the human history.
Yeah. And I think also, that's amazing. He saw it coming because when he started dissociating himself from doing the shipping with FedEx and all those other companies, by him creating his own transportation, then it's kind of like, okay, now we have transportation in-house. That's when also the cakes start rolling in even more, Because now you have better contracts, even with the, if it's air companies, I'm pretty sure that now he has different contracts as opposed to FedEx. They're still in the picture, but, he probably has better contracts with the companies that will fly his products. Yeah. I mean, the fact that he has his own vans, that was just genius,
Well, that guy, I think what that guy did was we thought, iPhone was innovative. Tesla is innovative. This guy sideswiped all those guys because all those things you can sell on Amazon. You can sell Tesla on Amazon if you want. You can sell
on Amazon. Do they have cars on Amazon?
Huh?
Do they have cars on Amazon?
Price?
Cars.
You could buy a motorcycle on Amazon, shipped from China, put together.
Yeah, by the way, you have a great motorcycle.
I already outgrown it. I'm looking for a new one now.
You outgrew it already?
Yeah, I'm already outgrown it because it's very small. It's a 230cc and it's not even. Once you learn how to bike really well, you learn the fundamentals, you kind of see how it starts to fill the slope. When you start riding a bike initially, it's so overwhelming. The machine is overwhelming, making all the controls. So the last thing you're thinking about is the speed.
Okay.
It's like trying to drive a car that's a three-cylinder car. You've never driven a car before. Who cares about how fast it goes? You're scared as hell. But you're just thinking about, oh, my God, how do I shift or how do I press the pedal? How do I stop so I don't hit somebody else? But once you know how to do all that, all of a sudden, the car, you just find out the car is a three-banger and everybody's taking off on the light and you're still there waiting.
Right,
what happens with my motorcycle. In 3 months of riding the motorcycle, I just figure, oh, my God, this is so slow. It is ridiculous.
So was this your first motorcycle?
My first motorcycle, yeah.
Yeah, you got to start small because you don't want to get into a situation where you have this big engine and then you just take off, you know?
Now what I'm actually finding out is, because I've done quite a lot of research, is there are different types of, just like, you know, you could have a luxury car that drives very smooth, and you can have a car that drives fairly fast and gets you in trouble. Same thing with motorcycles. So with the Honda engine, like the older Honda engine, they have a lot of power, but they don't give you a lot of those powers until you start driving really fast.
Okay.
But by that time, you're already conscious of safety. So when you go more fine, they kind of slow and steady. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to get a Honda CV. You know, I'm going from a four-cylinder to a 8-cylinder or 12-cylinder, but it's a kind of different, the way it's tuned is different. It's tuned for slow and steady off the line and then gradual speed overall.
Yeah. Yes, sounds good. Well, wonderful, Dari. It was great having a conversation with you. And
thank you.
Definitely. Hopefully we were able to enlighten some of our listeners in regards to real estate. Real estate for me always been something that I had a passion for. And I still tell myself that one of these days I'm going to sell some houses, you know. But I love the process. I loved it when I bought my first house. Looking forward to buy more. I dab into short-term rental. So that's my contribution to real estate. And yeah, it's a wonderful thing. And hopefully we'll be able to educate folks also on programs. I'm going to try to attach some links here about programs that could help with hardship during this time for people that are renting and then also for people that are actually they actually have a mortgage, you know?
Yeah, there's actually a program right now that has been just recently got. Let me show you some details about it. I was sharing it on my listing too. This program right here is a new program that the National Association of Realtors just helped put out there to the federal government. It's going to be a $1 trillion program. And this program is geared towards, you know, up till like this month, all they were just doing was, oh, we're putting moratorium on late fee eviction. They were not talking about anything about, oh, are we going to give relief to people in terms of their utility, in terms of their mortgage relief, all those things we were talking about. The federal government hasn't talked about anything regarding those things. So All they kept talking about is, oh, don't charge people if they're late. Don't evict them if they haven't paid. You know, but what about they don't have a job? The $100,000 you're sending them isn't going to do anything.
Right. And
I think that they get caught up in their minds. Like, okay, we're sending people $1,000, but we're sending big company millions of dollars. And then, they feel like, oh, maybe that's a handout. So we have to hold up and think properly about it next time. And now they're not going to send the next one until June. And so you have the one they sent back in March. So April's already lapsed for people that are paying rent. May's about to lapse. June, when in June? I mean, come on, that's like 90 days late. The guy that owns the building hasn't collected 90 days. The person hasn't paid in 90 days. They didn't even say anything about reporting. So this new policy right here, reporting on your credit report, right? because none of this thing is anybody's fault, right? Mm-hmm. So this new policy is actually going to address a few things. It's going to address, number one, the mortgage relief that you talked about, right? And then the mortgage assistance for homeowners to reinstate or lower their mortgage payment. The payment for taxes, insurance, homeowners association fees, your utility bills, things like, you know, prevention, preventive evictions, and mortgage delinquency. And more importantly is, you know, your credit reporting, right?
Right.
That's, you know, if after 90 days you haven't paid your mortgage, in California, there's a, it's called notice of default. They filed a notice of default with the county clerk's office that you haven't paid your mortgage in 90 days. And that is the initial steps in foreclosure. So it's very critical that the federal government, you know, is thinking ahead about all these things and not playing behind the ball. They're playing behind the ball, like they're coming up with solutions after stuff already happened. They're not being preemptive on any of these measures at all. So these are stuff that, you know, National Association of Realtors have put together. It's called the HERO Act, and it's going to help address some of these issues. But not just mortgage and student loans and things like that, but also, as you can see on the content, it's also going to help with small businesses, commercial businesses, unemployment, tax, health insurance, broadband, and all the things, family sick leaves, and it's just all the stuff. So if any of the audience want any of this, they could go either to my Facebook page on Sanctum Realty and download it. It's there. Or actually, I could also share it with you. I don't know if there's a way I could share it with you. I could probably send it to you afterwards. You can share.
Yes, send me the files. Thank you very much. This is very good information.
Yeah. So these are the information that they could look into. And this is actually something that's in works, to be honest. This was filed back. This was put together in May 12th, and it was sent out to the Congress, I think, on May 14th. So it's being worked on right now.
Wow. But
all of this stuff is just very, very, very behind the ball. You know, it's just not, it's not cool how the federal government is treating people. You come out of these things, your credit is shot. You couldn't work because government tell you to stay home. And then, you know, the credit companies are hounding you, but why are they hounding you when they know you don't have a job, when the whole world is at a full stop? Why you continue to send people bills?
Right.
They don't have a job and and everybody's living from, you know, from paycheck to paycheck, from mouth to, you know, work to, you know, nobody has extra money saved. An average American doesn't even have a, you know, $150 in their savings account. And you send in their, you know, them to credit reporting, you're hounding them. It just doesn't make a lot of sense. And the government is saying, oh, we're going to wait till June to send you the next check. You know, it's a very disaster in terms of the whole process right now.
Yes.
So,